Welcome back. In this video, we'll be talking about Revit's five orders of classic architecture. As you all know, there are three classic orders: the Corinthian, the Ionic, and the Doric, or rather the Doric, Ionic, and Corinthian. But there's two more orders that we'll be discussing as well. There are derivatives of the other three. In the Greek and Roman architecture. So our focus is not so much on the classic part of this and the architectural design, but more on how to model this inside of Revit. What are some of the techniques that we can use in order to do that in building information modeling? So let's get started. So there's actually before the Doric order, there was an order called Tuscan order, which is really essentially a smooth Doric column. The Doric order is a little bit more ornamental, as you can see here on the right hand side. So we have the Tuscan is just a simple column with a little bit of curvature, with a simple capital and a simple base. The Doric order is very similar, except it may have a fluted column, it may have an ornamental top, and it will have some also ornamental entablature. The Ionic column is characterized by a double bulge here in the base, and this iconic capital, which looks like a horn of a sheep, if you will, and also a little bit more ornament in the entablature above. The Corinthian order is characterized by this leaf-like capital, so it's very easy to recognize from all the others. And then there is also a composite order, which is essentially a composite of the Ionic and the Corinthian. So as you can see here in the capital of the composite, it's a Corinthian capital plus it's an Ionic capital, so it has the horn like ornament on the top. So the Tuscan order again is one of the two classic orders developed by the Romans, and the other being the composite order. So the Tuscan and the composite is a Roman addition to the Greek influence. So the Tuscan is greatly influenced by the Doric order, but with unfluted column. Okay, so it's smooth, and if you live in the United States and you go to the Home Depot or Lowe's home improvement store, you can buy a Tuscan column that's made up of fiberglass. For mostly for residential construction, but it may also be used for other applications as well. And surprisingly, the fiberglass column is structural in nature, which something I didn't know before. So the Romans did not consider the style to be a distinct architectural order. The Roman architect Vitruvius did not include it in alongside its description of the Greek Doric, Ionic, and Corinthian orders. So it came apparently later to simplify things. The Tuscan order is seen as similar to the Doric order, and yet its overall proportions, intercolumnation, and its simpler entablature, it follows the ratio of the Ionic. Okay, so although it looks like a Doric, it actually follows the ratio of the Ionic. And this strong order was considered most appropriate in military architecture, and it's in docks and warehouses where they were dignified by architectural treatment suitable to fortified places such as city gates, fortresses, castles, treasuries, or other artillery and ammunition are kept, prisons, seaports, and other similar structures used in war. So it is a sign of power, it's a sign of stability, and a sign of the state, you know, the government. So you will see it a lot in many places around, Europe as well as United States in Washington, D.C. Here's an example of the Tuscan Order. This is a church in London, St. Paul's Church in London. It uses the Tuscan Order in order to establish authority and order. It is also the columns in the middle are round, but then the columns on the edges are square. Okay. All right. Let's go move to the Doric Order. The Doric Order has one of three orders of ancient Greek and Roman architecture. The Doric is easily recognized by the simple circular capitals on the top of the column. Okay, so this is circular, and then it is the simplest of orders, though it's still with complex details in the entablature above. So they added over the years. They added this dentil molding on the top, and they added these relief sculptures as well as some other things you see on the end of the pediment. The Doric order column was fluted or smooth surfaced and had no base, dropping straight into the ground. So you don't see it actually here, but the base is, it doesn't have it just the shaft hits the ground without any base in some cases. The capital was simple circular form with some moldings under a square cushion that is very wide in early versions, but later more restrained. Above a plain architrave, the complexity comes from the frieze. So this is the frieze right here. The ancient architect and architectural historian Vitruvius associates the Doric representation representing the masculine. So this is interestingly, this is the masculine of the buildings, while the next one we'll see in a moment represents the feminine. An example of the Doric order is the Parthenon in Athens, Greece, which is world famous for its early Greek architecture. And you can see here clearly that the column at the bottom does not have a base, and that's the early version of the Doric order. Later on, they added the base. So again, it could be with or without a base. This beautiful architrave here, and there are some relief patterns just like this one right here, and they kind of repeat in a certain pattern. So it's kind of very musical, right? So it's like a b, you know, it repeats itself. So the distance, of course, between columns is constant, which establishes a rhythm that is very much associated with the classic architecture. Let's talk about the Ionic order. The Ionic order, compared to the Corinthian and the Doric orders, it's kind of in the middle. So in the classic order, you have the Corinthian, then the Ionic, and then the Doric. The Corinthian has the slimmest column of all, and then the Ionic comes after, and then the Doric. The Ionic capital is characterized by the use of volutes. We're talking about these horn-like structure that sits on top of the capital. Okay, so the Ionic columns normally stand on a base, which separates the shaft of the column from the platform. Okay, while the cap is usually enriched with egg and dart. So if you look very carefully here, these are the egg-like motif that they're talking about. So there is a dart in between the eggs, and then we have the egg every now and then. So this is definitely a later addition to the order. So the ancient architect and architectural historian Vitruvius associates the Ionic with the feminine proportions. So the Doric, we said, was the masculine, and the Ionic was the feminine proportion. That's one of the reasons, if you look back at the Greek architecture, I'm not showing it here, but sometimes they show an actual human figure where you have like a woman actually carrying the capital. So they're sitting, their feet is on the base, and they're carrying the capital above. An example of Ionic architecture is this building, called Erectum, in Athens, Greece. It has a beautiful Ionic capital, and then we have the egg and the dart, also a motif, and some plant-like structures here. So these are actually, pretty easy to model in Revit. I'll talk about that in a moment when we get to that part. But of course, the spiral part is a tough one. The Corinthian order is an ancient Greek architecture, and it was mostly used by the Romans in later architecture. But so we don't see it much in the Greek architecture, but we see it more in the Roman architecture. It's characterized by the fluted columns, also by the leaf-like capitals. That is pretty complex to, if you think about it, to make this out of stone is a pretty daunting task. So I would imagine doing this in Revit would also be quite a bit of a challenge. Example of the Corinthian order is the Roman Temple of Bacchus in Baalbek, Lebanon, where you can see the scale of this building. This is gigantic. This is a man right here walking on top. So this is just the base of the temple is bigger than a building. There's another person here standing. So it's surprisingly it's very well preserved, although many earthquakes have came and went on this region, and I think it was restored. Some of the columns kind of fell over the years, but it's amazing how well it's very, very well preserved. And this building is so well preserved that the interior was used by an orchestra a few years ago. It was very successful. It's a great outdoor because it doesn't have a roof on top. There's no roof up here. That played classical music. Okay, the composite order, as I said before, is a composite of the Corinthian and the Ionic. So you can see in the capital here, over in here too, is the Ionic horn-like motif is available alongside with the leaf-like structure at the bottom. And then at the bottom here, we have these triple kind of rings, if you will, at the base. So it's a mixed style. In many versions of the composite order, the volutes are longer, and there is generally some ornament placed centrally between the volutes, and the column of the composite order is typically 10 diameters high. Okay, so the height of the column has to do with the diameter of the column itself. So this is the ratio, 10 times the diameter. Though, as with all these orders, the details may be adjusted by the architect or particular building. The composite order is essentially treated as a Corinthian, except for the capital, with no consistent differences to that above or below the capital. Okay. So it's basically a Corinthian column. The only difference is essentially that there is an Ionic addition here. The composite order is not found in the ancient Greek architecture and until the Renaissance, so it's a later addition. Here's an example of the composite order, the Arch of Titus in Rome. You can see here the capitals are like that. There's also different variations on the leaf structure, so the leaf can be like complex with a lot of detail, like this one over here, this one, this one, this one, while this one over here and that one is more of a simplified leaf. Okay, so essentially it boils down to these three orders. We have five orders, but then these three are the main ones: the Doric, the Ionic, and the Corinthian, which are very well known for architects around the world. The Each column is made up of a base, a shaft, capital, the abacus, which holds the architrave. The architrave is is the linear element that's part of the building. And then we have the frieze, the dentil moldings, and the cornice. So these are the appropriate names for this. So this all of these things, the old cornice, the dentils, the frieze, and the architrave make the entablature. And there are different variations of those depending on whether it's Greek or Roman. It shows different battles, epic battles in the past. So that was great, but how to model this in Revit? I've taken a stab at this, and I have modeled some of those before in the past. So number one is the top of the building where we have the the entablature, the cornice part of the entablature, right? So the cornice part of the entablature can be created using wall sweeps and reveals. Okay, so this can be a wall with a sweep or reveal. The dentil molding, which is over here, dentils, looks like teeth. This can be a line-based array, rectangular or radial, depending on how it's made. And the next part, which is the abacus, is an extrusion, revolve, or sweep. It can also be part of the wall. If it's part of the wall, then it's a sweep or reveal. Then we have the shaft itself is a blend, swept blend, because it tapers. You can see the base is wider than the top, so it kind of tapers up. So it's not just a simple cylinder, it's a tapered cylinder. And therefore, it's a blend. And then we have the Ionic capital. This can be an in-place component. And the Corinthian can be a in-place component as well, but I'm proposing here that sometimes this can be very complex. And if it is complex, you can do the purchase part of this, like a couple of leaves here, and then do an array around the column, but that they just may take a lot of work. So depending on the result, this can be very demanding on your model. And so you could actually do that with a laser scan. You can scan the capital and then bring it in into Revit and create a model out of it. Of course, the base is similar to the capital in a way that this can be done with either a with extrusion, revolves, or sweeps. So it is complex, but once you have figured out how to do one column, obviously the remaining part is easy, because all you have to do is just copy and copy, copy, and array and repeat, right? So if you can figure out how to do one part of the building, the remaining part should be straightforward. I hope this was useful information, especially for students of architecture and those who are interested in creating a final project using classic architecture. Thank you for watching and listening, and liking my videos and subscribing. Take care now. Bye-bye.